Ashet Audio presents Poor Little Sick Girls, a love letter to unacceptable women, written by Ione Gamble and read by the author. Introduction. I've always had a complicated relationship with the void, defined by Oxford languages as, noun, a completely empty space, the black void of space. A vast emptiness, a concept to describe the incomprehensible. The void has become a catch-all among my generation for the general lack of purpose or feeling of belonging many experience when moving through the universe. Don't get me wrong, it's not as if I've never considered my place in the world, who I am and why I was put on the planet. I've read about existentialism, not from philosophers, but from women my age on the internet. I've scrolled through relatable viral tweet after relatable viral tweet about the vast emptiness of existence. I've even double-tapped a few. But on the whole, as someone who was diagnosed with a chronic illness in their late teens, the void itself has never been something I've fully understood or felt. Growing up in the early age of social media, I was surrounded by my peers, wondering where they fitted in. First through the lens of teen angst and coming-of-age girl rage, filtered through confessional Tumblr posts and autobiographical artwork dealing with the trials and tribulations of growing up. I gazed at my laptop screen as accounts I followed banded together to take on the world's wrongs, to make sense of the mess that is femininity, and to push against the still restrictive stereotypes projected onto girls both on and off the internet. I admired those around me, filling their voids with a sense of community, belonging, and purpose. I gorged on the work published by people much more confident than me, unable to fully comprehend their confusion about our reality, but awestruck by their ability to post their thoughts without fear of judgment. My generation's struggle to get a grasp on what our place is doesn't subside as we enter adulthood. We're the least likely to own our own house, to marry, or to put down any tangible roots. We've had to grow up under right-wing governments who stripped away, one by one, the benefits experienced by our parents. However, while those around me bathe in uncertainty, I've always felt annoyingly sure of who I was meant to be. As a child, I would create mental checklists of what my adulthood would look like. I'd carve myself out full careers, choose which university course to study years before I could apply, and work quietly but tirelessly to make sure my future would be the one I expected. Daydreaming about my future self was a far more effective form of escapism than any book, film, or other outlet would allow me. I'd plan years of my life well in advance, where I would live, the type of work I would undertake. I spent my teen years convinced that my life would really start if I could just plan my future well enough to make it past growing up. What I didn't account for in an infancy spent preparing for adulthood was being diagnosed with an incurable illness before I'd even turned 20. 4 months into my first year at university, I was rushed into the acute medical ward of Epsom Hospital, following over 6 months of internal bleeding, weight loss, and a strange habit of fainting at any given moment. After spending the first 24 hours in a haze of sedation and confusion, I came to, hooked up to a drip of steroids and being spoken to by doctors who provided few answers. Even when faced with a world-altering medical condition, I remained irritatingly insistent that a diagnosis of Crohn's disease wouldn't screw up my plans. During my first hospital stay, I ignored the advice of doctors who urged me to rest, and instead made the astute decision to temporarily discharge myself to attend a seminar at university, despite medical professionals advising me I could very easily die if I did so. I might have chosen to ignore both my clinicians and my body in favour of attempting to further my education, but in the days that followed, I learnt that my health, or lack thereof, would have more of an impact on my life than a 2-1 from a middling university. Crohn's disease is a type of inflammatory bowel disease. Little is known about it, but many classify the illness as an autoimmune condition. In short, my digestive system views itself as a foreign object it should attack. Severity of the condition varies, but my symptoms include abdominal pain, low energy, and a general feeling of having no idea what is going on with my bowels. It's unknown why people contract Crohn's. It's not easily pinpointed to one specific trigger. Anything from unlucky genes to stress, a food group, lack of sleep, or an internal bodily reaction can set the disease in motion. During the first couple of years of my life as a chronically ill woman, I refused to believe my condition would be any more prominent in my life than a minor inconvenience. Despite hospital stays, medication changes, and multiple specialist appointments, despite having to inject myself with immunosuppressants, suffering extreme joint pain and debilitating fatigue, I set about my predetermined plans as if nothing had happened. When approaching life with such extreme denial and tunnel vision, the void seemed further away than ever before. I discovered very quickly that the problem with ignoring something is that it doesn't make it disappear. While I remain clear on the direction I wish my life to take, my body had different plans. Quantifiably, as the months ticked by, my condition was improving. Inflammatory markers derived from blood tests were down, my stomach was healing itself from the inside, and I was being tapered off the steroids that bloated my face. But moving from university to the working world, I was faced with the realization that my Crohn's disease wouldn't diminish just because I willed it to. The more the disease settled into my body, the more I realized my symptoms wouldn't budge. I'd spend hours staring at a screen, completely overcome by brain fog that refused to dissipate despite looming deadlines. Required to spend long days at my desk, I found myself instead locked in the staff loo, doubled over in pain and unable to move. As my symptoms became more and more prevalent, anxiety mounted, and the thought of entering the office each day filled me with dread. I left my dream job due to my employers being unable to adapt to my position to accommodate my illness. Through a combination of my inability to work a normal 9-to-5 and my body's insistence on shutting down, which forced me to sleep for a few hours in the middle of the day, my condition was met with gross misunderstanding from the majority of people I came into contact with. Piece by piece, the vision I conjured of what my adult life would look like began to fall apart. Following the early years of my diagnosis, I began to make sense of what the void meant to me. If anything, it has become increasingly tangible for me, as the void exists inside my body as a muddling mess of illness and unanswered questions. I've seen printed out pictures of my own insides taken with cameras inserted down my throat, but I'm yet to be convinced there is little more behind my bones than a big black hole. I can feel my muscles cramping, but no matter the number of doctor's appointments I attend, I'm no closer to figuring out why they do. For chronically ill people, the ability to ponder what all of this life stuff means is a luxury. To pause and consider our larger existence on this planet would require us to overlook our own internal physical but invisible pain. Ignoring the void and refusing to acknowledge what often seems like the pointlessness of our existence is a means of survival. Left unchecked, I could spend hours burrowing into self-pity and self-loathing. For some, the concept of succumbing to the void is enough in and of itself to isolate them. But it is my body that separates me from the rest of the world, not my inability to find a meaningful place within it. To spend too much time searching inside myself for answers, whether with the help of medical professionals or independently, is to slip into the void, and to accept that my meaning will always be contingent on something I have no control over. The lack of clarity as to why my broken body refuses to heal itself is enough to incite a lifetime's worth of dread. Perhaps my refusal to spend too much time considering the fragile nature of how my insides operate is another form of void avoidance. It could be argued that my misunderstanding of why this uncertainty consumes so many of those around me isn't a misunderstanding at all, but a refusal to accept reality. While my own anxieties are projected internally onto myself, my void is fundamentally no different to those who feel engulfed by the largeness of the universe. Everyone has their issues. As I came to terms with my condition, I began ignoring my own internal bodily mess in favor of filling up my mind with other people's stories, consuming as much as I could about women's pain. I became convinced that if I armed myself with enough knowledge on the subject, I would find a way to be at peace with it. Historically, the unwell have been written out of existence. Until recent history, it appeared near impossible to find an example of sickness, mental illness, or those who don't fall into our narrow, westernized beauty standards that wasn't focused on the negative stigma attached to those identity markers. With no positive role models to point towards, allowing yourself the kindness and consideration you would automatically apply to those around you is not an easy thing. In the case of chronic health conditions, this can largely be attributed to the willful ignorance of the majority of able-bodied societies, or their outward insistence on ignoring those who are unwell. But we also have a part to play in our own invisibility. In the initial stages of my life as an ill woman, I led myself to believe that my condition was not worthy of any outward headspace. My internalized ableism ensured I never spoke more than a whisper about what I was going through. My insistence on refuting the void kept me tight-lipped when discussing my own personal experiences. In contrast, social politics and fourth wave feminism have defined my early 20s. I came of age with the internet. I've witnessed the explosion of body positivity, self-care, and a wider understanding of identity politics into our everyday lexicon. The internet was the first place I turned to when looking for answers about my condition. I spent hours searching social media networks for tips and tricks on how to cope when muddling through the world felt impossible. I can attribute all of my favourite films, bands, designers, and artists to an obsession with seeking things out online. Before feminism became fodder for the advertising industry, logging onto my laptop felt like accessing a portal to another universe, one in which people with experiences similar to my own didn't feel choked by the facets of themselves that traditionally made them weak. After spending my teenage years lurking behind a keyboard, post-diagnosis I was able to mobilise those years spent on my laptop fangirling into confidence that pushed me to find my own community and seek out the spaces I longed to see in the world. With the internet and social media allowing marginalised people total autonomy over their stories, perhaps for the first time in modern history, our narratives have never been easier to disseminate across the world. With a focus on greater representation resulting in a more equal world, my generation's activism pushes for acceptance of our differences. Both online and in real life, my peer group has cultivated the ability to find common ground within the aspects of ourselves that have traditionally forced us to feel isolated. When much of your time is spent housebound due to unbearable pain, life online has a funny way of swallowing you up, for better or for worse. While I found great comfort in immersing myself in online communities during the first years of my diagnosis, spending so much time on the internet has become infinitely more confusing as the end of my 20s creeped towards me. In recent years, socio-political activism has steered its focus towards greater representation for marginalised identities. While collective action grouped my peers and me together as I came of age, individual recognition is now the driving motivation for many currently operating in online spaces. As someone with an invisible illness, representation can seem like an impossible plight. While there is a huge comfort to be derived from seeing others being openly, unapologetically themselves, things become more complicated when the very thing that marginalises you is largely impossible for anyone else to see. For every time I have found a genuine community, a cynical URL girl gang is peddling social hierarchy under the guise of uplifting other femmes. For every phrase adopted to help those ignored within popular culture, capitalism finds a way to use the very thing that brought you comfort to sell you back insecurity. Once upon a time, existing online felt like belonging to a secret club of similar experience. Now, the new ilk of identity politics is a language we all speak. This democratization of the tools and words that seek to empower us is largely a positive thing. It's created a means for us all to express the frustrations that come with a lifetime of feeling invisible. However, the popularity of social politics in the online world has let consumerist endeavors steal the coping mechanisms many of us spent our formative years figuring out. Those who sought greater acceptance on the internet during their teens have grown up to realise that being more visible does not automatically mean we're inciting real, meaningful change. At one point in my life, the internet felt like holding a mirror up to myself, even if those I related to didn't directly experience the same things I did. Now, authenticity is even more difficult to determine online than in physical spaces. The mirrors we all seek in order to assert who we are have become distorted. Where the internet used to be a safe haven to dispel the creeping omnipresence of the void in my existence, the pressure to live our best life has cultivated an online world that reflects the outer world's murky value system. Although my physical sense of personhood may feel constantly in flux, my sense of what is important has only been cemented by living as a person with Crohn's disease. The freedom I found from being a medically confirmed sick, sad girl is almost equal to the restrictions I experience in terms of my illness. After spending the first portion of my life riddled with self-doubt, being diagnosed with an incurable medical condition has had a funny way of teaching me to not give a fuck. For every person that dismissed my diagnosis due to its invisibility, I became more and more certain that playing down its effect on my life was doing more harm than good. For every willfully ignorant comment that looped in my mind, I became determined to push my perceived flaws, my illness, my fatness, my mental instability, onto the world as facets of humanity that should be not just accepted, but loved and adored. While I might lament the hours spent tucked up under the covers, unable to move and in isolation from my peers, the void did not rear its ugly head. My invisible illness has willed me to ask for more from my circumstances than I was offered. Crohn's disease has pushed me to carve a place for myself in a world that negates my existence and demands optimum productivity while rewarding peak wellness. My condition allows me to view both the on and offline world with a fierce cynicism, while pushing me to constantly find the brightness within it. To move away from a void that lives within you is essentially an impossible task. It's easy to feel dispensable when your identity is intertwined with illness. You move through your life as a personification of the thing many people fear will happen to them one day. But to embrace the condition that by default makes you undesirable to the majority of our society holds an inherent power. To take back the parts of yourself you've learned to bury opens up a world of infinite possibility. As I wade through adult life, my ability to accept the void that is my body strengthens. Piece by piece, I'm learning that we're worthy of writing ourselves back into our own stories, and that history can no longer afford to ignore us. One, the tragic and gorgeous history of the sick girl. Nobody wants to be sick. More often than not, we do as much as we can to avoid it. We cower from people who cough on public transport, avoid making doctor's appointments, and push health concerns to the side for months on end until it's no longer possible to ignore them. It's understandable. Being ill isn't fun. It ruins our plans and makes us feel like shit. But beyond the physical symptoms, we're taught that getting sick is a sign of weakness, and to become unwell is to lose our usefulness to society. If you're a marginalized person, this is a particularly unsettling thought, with our place in the world seeming fragile at even the best of times. The idea of being permanently unwell becomes even more unappealing when we realise that chronically ill and disabled people are treated with a near total disregard for their existence. Unwell and disabled people move through a world that has no interest in accommodating us. Only 60 out of 270 London tube stations have partial accessibility. There are only 900 public toilets for a population of nearly 9 million in the same city. And when it comes to clothing, there are more options for dogs than there are for people with disabilities. Being sick is also embarrassing. It implies you cannot care for yourself to the standard that other people manage to, that your body is out of control, and that if your illness is contagious, you're happy to spread disease among others. Our idea of sickness is explicitly tied up with fear. Initially, a fear of being unwell stems from the worry of embarrassing ourselves. Nobody wants to throw up in public, have to run to a toilet, sweat excessively, or say they're unable to climb a flight of stairs. But this embarrassment is merely a mask for something darker. The fear we feel about illness and all its associated symptoms directly correlates to the idea that not only does being unwell reduce quality of life, it closes the gap between life and death. To be unwell is to be the living and breathing epitome of what will eventually come for us all, the end of our lives. In extreme cases, the idea that you should even be alive as a disabled or chronically ill person is called into question by the people you love the most, as if you're a wounded baby animal begging to be put down. But for some of us, sickness isn't a choice, and we can't opt out. There is no avoiding the fear, disgust, and contempt many people have for us. There is no avoiding the looming fear that our lives may be cut short. Being perpetually unwell is something we have to live with. When I was first diagnosed with Crohn's disease, it felt like I was the only person in the world who was experiencing facing the rest of their life as an unwell person. Of course, I had heard about sick people before, but these tales were usually packaged within the context of terminal conditions, or those reaching the later stages of their life in which health complications are more common and seem further away. The stories of those diagnosed when young always had tragic endings and alluded to a short, sharp, and sudden decline in health. The first few weeks, months, and even years after diagnosis were extremely lonely, not because I didn't have the support of those around me, but because I didn't know anyone else who was experiencing anything remotely similar to what I was going through. No matter how many hours I spent Googling my condition, stalking forums, and joining Facebook groups, I still felt completely isolated. I had no idea what a person like me looked like or how they lived their lives. It seemed impossible that we could have ambitions beyond merely existing, that we could achieve our dreams, have successful careers, or happy families. For a while, it felt as though my life would spiral into irrelevance, with my sole concerns being dictated by a disease I had no power over. The reason why stories of women suffering from illness and invisible disability are so few and far between is not because they don't exist. Every year, 33,000 people are newly diagnosed with Crohn's disease, with over 4 million people in the UK living with autoimmune diseases, a statistic that is thought to be underreported. Crohn's disease is more prevalent in women, with autoimmune diseases in general being twice as likely to affect women as their male counterparts. The precise reasons for this imbalance are still unknown, as is so much about the nature of autoimmune conditions. But theories point towards our increased hormonal shifts and an additional X chromosome, meaning women's genetic makeup leaves us more prone to developing a tendency for our bodily cells to attack themselves. Over the course of the COVID-19 pandemic, we have all experienced the fear of becoming unwell, and we are now seeing an entire new population of chronically ill people, those living with long COVID. However, despite the fact that vast swathes of us are experiencing disease to varying degrees, illness still persists as an extreme modern taboo. A taboo that leads many women who deal with chronic health conditions to refuse to talk about or acknowledge them altogether. More than simply feeling uncomfortable when the topic arises, we often aim to keep our illnesses hidden for as long as possible. Admitting you're unwell and openly talking about your condition leaves you extremely vulnerable. People take you less seriously, believe you're incapable, and overwhelm you with a sympathy you never wanted. Growing up as part of Generation Overshare, with easy internet access and my peers writing their every thought and feeling in blog posts, I initially struggled to understand the resistance to openly admitting a long-term medical condition. I came of age believing that the act of simply talking about the things that held us back would help us progress into a more equal society. However, I quickly learned this was not the case. To talk about illness, about all the disgusting things that happen both inside and because of your body, is to allow people to be openly fearful of your existence. Well, people, once you admit you are sick, will spend the duration of your relationship tiptoeing around you, whether they consciously realize it or not. Though this reaction isn't necessarily malicious, the fact that we don't know how to behave around sick people reinforces our negative societal feelings about those who are unwell and perpetuates fear through silence, further isolating those who live with health conditions. As I became more used to being sick, I began to hide my condition more frequently, not because I was embarrassed, but because I was tired of how others responded to my admission. Disclosing every blood test, hospital visit, or intrusive test would unwittingly invite either a barrage of questions relating to every scientific detail of my symptoms, or a pitying stare and pat on the back that would make me feel no more respected than a toddler. Considering how society treats those who are sick, it's unsurprising that women in the spotlight who live with ongoing illness are often secretive about their conditions. Determined to find role models who didn't fall into the category of CEOs, models turned activists, or wellness gurus, I embarked on an all-encompassing mission to find women whose experiences mirrored my own more closely. After hours and hours spent exploring the cultural crevices of online listicles, obscure books, and the deepest depths of Netflix, I started to access a world in which I was no longer alone. I can now list every household name in the last century who has experienced chronic health conditions. For example, John F. Kennedy and Kurt Cobain both had Crohn's disease. I can recall every cultural artifact with a marginal connection to illness, like the fact that Alien, 1979, is supposedly inspired by the writer's experience with Crohn's, with the alien itself representing the extreme, squirming nature of stomach pain. But what I learned about how society treats those who are in the spotlight while also being chronically ill was far from encouraging. While I managed to find what I was looking for, it became clear that representation of famous women's illnesses is largely either diminished or romanticized. Those who buy a Frida Kahlo tea towel or sofa cushion may never become aware of the multiple surgeries, complications, and periods of ill health she dealt with throughout her life. The Mexican artist has become a symbol for female empowerment, with her thick monobrow serving as a fuck you to beauty standards, her countless self-portraits a precursor to our modern obsession with the self, and the fact that she is probably one of the few female artists most people know by name. While our love for Kahlo may come from a vaguely political place, the reality of her existence has become completely sanitized, with her icon status eclipsing the real reasons we should love her in the first place. Conversely, people who are aware of her personal history are quick to paint her as a woman riddled with disease and using art as the only escape from her sad existence. Carla was diagnosed with polio at age 6, which caused her chronic pain throughout her life. At 18 years old, she was in a bus accident, leading to multiple injuries. She spent months in bed and underwent over 30 surgeries to treat various complications. The accident and its subsequent aftershocks also affected her fertility, and she experienced multiple miscarriages. Spending so much time bedridden and alone, she adapted her easel to accommodate her condition, with a mirror propped appropriately so she could paint herself. Creating work provided Carlo with an opportunity to separate herself from the pain of her life, while representing her experiences and trauma. Walking around a recent London exhibition featuring the artist's wardrobe, accessories, and personal items, I came to realise just how pitied Carlo still is despite all her success. As I moved through rooms showcasing her makeup compacts displayed next to medical devices and the plaster corset she had to wear for much of her life, her wedding dress alongside medicine bottles, it became obvious that once people see illness, they struggle to see anything else. Hearing how others spoke about her in whispers was a jarring experience. While I saw inspiring resilience and creativity, many attendees at the exhibition regarded her as a woman whose suffering came to define her. Pity, in the visitor's eye, overwhelmed above all else. It is tempting to view Carla as someone who triumphed in spite of the many physical barriers in her way. But in reality, the reason she was able to create such iconic work was because of her illness, not in spite of it. Her experiences with pain allowed an insight into femininity that her peers did not possess, handing her a unique set of perspectives that resonate among many of us regardless of health status. Instead of romanticizing her ability to push through the pain, we should try to understand how it informed and shaped her work as much as any other part of her life, for better or for worse. While Carlo's history of illness is well documented, other famous women are less willing to embrace their condition as part of their creative process. Kathleen Hanna, Riot Girl pioneer and frontwoman of Bikini Kill, hid her Lyme disease diagnosis from the world, choosing to vanish into near obscurity while dealing with the condition. In the following years, during her return to public life, she did begin to open up about the effect of the disease on her well-being, but mostly in the context of missed tours and lost opportunities, as opposed to the physical and emotional turmoil of living with illness. Similarly, Lady Gaga only spoke about her experiences with fibromyalgia in 2017, just before the release of her Netflix documentary. In the film, we watch her writhe around on sofas due to extreme pain, visit doctors, and receive treatments. While this is a rare example of someone famous allowing the public candid access to her pain, in the years following the documentary, her fibromyalgia has been largely forgotten and rarely mentioned. On one of my many evenings early on in my diagnosis spent typing famous people with Crohn's disease and celebrities with chronic health conditions into search bars, I discovered that Shannon Doherty, star of Beverly Hills 90210, Charmed and Heathers, kept her Crohn's disease a secret for decades as it wasn't considered very sexy. This is a sentiment also echoed by writer Chris Krauss, who, while more forthcoming about her experience with Crohn's in her autobiographical novel I Love Dick, describes it as a disease that ultimately left her not only undesirable, but repulsive to her husband. Neither Krauss nor Doherty is inaccurate. Crohn's disease isn't sexy. Most people can't think of anything less appealing than dealing with a partner who could shit the bed at any moment and spends a huge proportion of their time in agony. With the woman's worth still so hugely being placed on how much sex appeal she possesses, the only way to retain any relevance to patriarchal society is to lie about vast swathes of our lives and conceal everything from cosmetic surgery to chronic illness. Our fear of being unsexy in the context of illness feeds all the way back to the fact that ultimately we consider unwell people to be a burden on society. No matter their talent or artistic genius, being sick is to be about as useless to the world as you can get. People feel undesirable for all sorts of reasons, but above most else, this fear of undesirability stems from a fear of rejection, something unwell people experience jarringly frequently in many forms and manners. We live with the fear of being rejected by those we love, denied care from our support networks, and cast aside onto a pile of people deemed unworthy of love. In relation to the endless list of ways in which women are expected to adapt their behaviour to fit the perfect vision of femininity constructed by men, creating an identity around sexual desirability has never been a personal priority. Early on in my life, at a time when most young women experience their sexual awakening, I realised I would never be a conventional vamp. My ability to project an aura of mystique has always been practically non-existent. I'm too loud, too fat, and incapable of keeping a secret for longer than 5 minutes. But though I've never spent too long agonising over my ability to seduce, I do feel immense guilt for putting the people I love through illness via osmosis. There are some people we can't hide our conditions from. Eventually, the romantic partners Doherty chose would have had to find out about her Crohn's, even when her production teams did not, and in the end, she did disclose her condition to the world. I've been with my partner since I was 15. We've grown up with each other through school, university, first jobs, and into adulthood, but the one thing he didn't sign up for was being lumbered with a perpetually sick person. As much as my life revolves around my condition, so does his. From every hospital appointment, to the days I'm too unwell to leave my bed, and the constantly changing lists of diagnoses and medication, it's not an ideal way to spend your 20s, even if the experience is secondhand. But although he's seen me in the most viscerally ugly and physically repulsive states I could possibly inhabit, the alternative is personally a far more scary option. Trading desirability for the opportunity to be truly understood and accepted is an easy decision. No matter my own guilt, I have to accept that he does not resent me for being unwell, that looking after me when I need care is not a burden, and that I am worth more than an abstract set of requirements equating to the right kind of woman. While Krause's condition may not have been sexually appealing, she recalls within her book's pages how it did help her ensnare her then-husband, Silver, with his desire to help her evolving into infatuation. Their love, to the outside eye, seems more pragmatic than led by a burning passion. They married so she could be added to his healthcare plan, and he was the only person able to talk her out of the emotional despair that resulted from a physical flare-up. Their story taught me that not all great love affairs require drama or mystery. Every sick girl needs at least one person whose behaviour never veers into condescending pity or refusal to accept reality, who won't openly wish they could help you get better and instead simply accepts the fact that your pain is a part of life. It still makes me cringe every time my Crohn's disease results in something traditionally embarrassing. I may not be able to control the outside judgment and projected perception from peers, colleagues, friends, or family. I equally can't curb the pangs of guilt every time I cancel on someone or upset them, or watch my boyfriend wash the dishes for the 10 millionth time because I'm in too much pain to do so. But to lie to my partner or anybody else about the reality of my condition would mean shrinking myself for the sole purpose of appealing palatable. Not only that, but it would mean closing myself off from the opportunity to really see the best in people. Yes, unwell people are treated like shit a lot of the time, but most of this ill will comes from a societal stigma and not a personal hatred. Experiencing all of my sick little life alongside my boyfriend has shown me that people can be truly unwavering when it comes to love, that humans are capable of caring completely and unselfishly, that the people around us really are willing to experience the worst of times with you alongside the best. If I chose to lie about or underplay my condition, I would live with the constant fear that if people found out the truth of my existence, I'd end up totally alone. The less we speak about our illnesses, the more we allow outside perception to dictate truth. Silence allows others to tell our stories, to decide what a sick person does or does not look like, and declare whose experiences are important and whose should be ignored. It remains rare to see a representation of illness that lays bare the often ugly reality of existing as an abnormality, that resists the categorization of either waif or powerhouse, helpless beauty or force of nature, because we still allow the patriarchy and non-disabled people to dictate the right type of unwell woman. Those who do open up about their experiences are subjected to an infantilization that often ensures they stay silent beyond those initial overshares. But beyond being babied, women who remain unfiltered in the telling of their lives are often regarded as unhinged, inappropriate, and out of control. Some of us choose to lean into this, with Krause describing her Crohn's disease as hysteria of the organs, and explicitly correlating her irritable bowel disease flaring up with her mental health declining. But being labelled as confessional or frequently being told we are oversharing when discussing illness are uncomfortable descriptors often placed upon us against our will. Why should asserting the very real things we go through be considered a confession? After recovering from cancer, losing her bladder, among other organs, and learning that she would have to live the rest of her life with a urostomy bag, artist Tracy Emin began taking nude selfies documenting her changing body. On publication of the images, the artist told The Guardian that she refuted the confessional label and the implication that freely speaking about her life, urostomy bag and all, constituted a performance. Emin's work has always laid bare the reality of womanhood, whether it be heartbreak, sexuality, or now illness. Her work is highly personal and was considered confessional long before her cancer diagnosis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.